Hello, YHS on Monster Island listeners. Jakey here. And even though you're hearing my voice first, and that typically means that Jake is not here this week, you would be wrong. Because even though he's technically not here for this recording session, you will be hearing from the Tattooed Titan of Tokusatsu. So loyal followers of Jacob Walsh, fear not. He will be in this episode. But since we couldn't meet up and have a formal typical recording session, we wanted to do something a little bit different, and I feel it could be a first, maybe not within the entire landscape of podcasting, but definitely within the YHS universe, and I hope you enjoy it. Like I said, it'll be a little bit different, something fun, but one of the really cool things about recording with Jake is that we do have opinions that typically align. You know, we like a lot of the same kaiju movies. We have issues with a lot of the same kaiju movies. And, you know, there are very few things I think that we disagree on. And we wanted to make sure that just wasn't because we're sitting there, we're having a lively conversation, and it just feels right to talk about something passionately when we see the other one talk passionately about it. And we thought that this would be a good way to do it is to take a film, one that's not universally loved, but not necessarily universally hated, and both of us record separately and see how well our thoughts align on such a film. So we decided to do that. And the film we chose, and I should say, I'm going to give Jake all the credit here. He picked a marvelous film because I think a lot of people have a lot of varying opinions on this film, is 1986's King Kong Lives, the sequel to 1976's King Kong, the reboot, the remake. A little controversial in its own right. And, you know, that was marred with so many issues, but that's for another podcast. So we both sat down, we both watched King Kong Lives, and we both recorded our thoughts on it, where we feel that it succeeded, where it failed, and kind of where our overall stance is on the film. And I'm very curious, and as I'm recording this right now, I have no idea if Jake's even watched the film yet. So I don't know. I have no idea if he likes it or dislikes it. And even when he was recommending it, he was very coy about it. He was very, very coy and made sure I didn't have any kind of hints whether it was a favorite of his or one that he detested, like I detest Godzilla versus Megaguirus. So, you know, sit back, enjoy, and let's see if we can come to some fisticuffs, maybe on our next episode, on how much we vehemently disagree on this film, or maybe we're going to be giving each other another bromance hug because, once again, we are in sync with our thoughts. And without further ado, we're going to start off hot. We're going to start off strong. We're going to start off with the man. Hey, I know you wouldn't be listening to this podcast if it wasn't for him. He's the creator of it, after all. And that, of course, is the ultimate aficionado of alligator eating, avalanche escaping, assault averting, army annihilating, artificial organ owning, enlarged apes. And he is Mr. Jacob Walsh.
Hello, guys. Thanks for tuning in for this, and thank you, Jay, for your intro. I appreciate that. Thanks for joining in. I know this is such a sort of a weird episode. It's kind of an experiment. Hey, much like maybe this movie was an experiment or a dare or something. Why was this movie made? I don't know. But we're going to talk about it. We're going to talk about King Kong Lives here, so let's do it. You know, for a movie called King Kong Lives, he sure does die a lot. Does he die three times in this movie? Maybe. Kind of. All right. I don't know what Jay thought of this movie, but I'm going to tell you, I'm going to give you reasons that you should watch this movie. I'm going to say that right off the bat. Is this a good movie? No? Is it a well-made movie? Not really. Is it fucking weird? Yeah, it's fucking weird. And it's definitely worth watching. It's got its moments. It does have its fun moments. I remember seeing this movie on TV as a kid, and I was super into it. And I don't know why or how this happens, but maybe this was on TV more than other than the other 70s Kong or any of the Kongs, but I feel like I remember watching this one more often. And now you can't even find this movie. I don't think it's available to rent anywhere. It's not streaming. I own it on VHS, and Jay bought it on VHS, and then I'm pretty sure he sold it right after he watched it. So that probably says a lot about what Jay thought of this movie. I'm very interested on what he thought. But it's a weird movie. And I remember as a kid, I'll jump a little in and out of order here. I'm not really going to just sit here and go straight through the plot, but I remember one of the things that stuck with me as a kid is there's a scene in this movie where Kong is walking through a swamp and he picks up an alligator and he eats the alligator. And then there's like a scene where he's just got like four or five alligators just hanging out of his mouth. And he's just walking around with them. And another thing that's weird is, you know, I took note on this newest watch through that when that scene happens, you're sort of watching that scene through the eyes of like a frog. It's like from the perspective of a frog. They show this frog sitting and he's like watching Kong, and you keep cutting back to the frog. And whenever Kong like, you know, takes a bite out of the alligator, it like dramatically zooms in. There's like a close up of the frog's eyes, which is a choice that was made. Very weird choice. I don't know why they did that, but I love it. I'm glad it's there. It's fucking weird. I'm gonna say it's fucking weird probably a lot of times. So this is a direct sequel to the other 70s Kong that came out that's a little more famous, and it's 10 years later. 10 years have passed, and right off the bat, the first thing they do is basically retcon the ending of the original, and Kong's not dead. He falls, he's shot up by the planes, he falls, and he's not dead. Which, you know, I think that always, whenever the retconning of an ending happens, it definitely cheapens the original. You know, you get that, such an emotional impact of Kong falling and dying, and that's how the movie ends, and then, hey, just kidding. He's not dead. Anything else, I think I'd be annoyed by that. But this movie is just so, here's that word again, weird, that I just don't care. I have to say that I applaud the fact that they use a man in suit for these. But that being said, it just doesn't have the charm of, you know, any like Toho film. It still doesn't quite work. I like it, but boy, it just sort of looks like a very cheap Halloween costume a lot of the times. So Kong's not dead, he's alive, and it's 10 years later and Kong's in Georgia. Why the fuck is he in Georgia? King Kong has been in a 10-year coma, just living in a warehouse in Georgia. That is so fucking weird. Okay. Kong's gonna die, basically. They need some blood. They need to fix his heart or something. Some weird bullshit that makes no sense, and they just so happen to find a Lady Kong at the same time, so they're deciding they're gonna, oh, and you know, they find the Lady Kong, and how do we know that it's a Lady Kong? Just give her Lady Kong breasts. Just that's it. Her color's different and she's got Kong boobs. So weird. He needs a heart. They're going to do some kind of a transplant. And so when this, something I want to talk about in this scene is that it is such a funny scene, unintentionally. This entire movie takes itself very seriously. And it is full of some of the dumbest, most silliest shit I've ever seen. They do surgery on King Kong with all these giant tools. And it's supposed to be like this tense moment. And it's very serious. And the music's very serious. And they're trying to make sure they give Kong his new heart and save him. But they have like comically large saws and scissors and tools, and it just looks so stupid. You cannot watch this movie with a straight face. I don't understand how this was even made, how this happened. Oh, another thing I want to say about, you know, not so much about the man in suit, but there's something weird about the sounds Kong and Lady Kong make in this movie. They're really bad. Especially Lady Kong. It sounds like they put no work into it. It literally just sounds like they waited to the last minute, realized they didn't do anything for the roars or the growls, and the sound man just got in and he just went like That's just what the whole thing sounds like. Okay. Kong wakes up. His heart worked. He smells Lady Kong. She's a mile away, but he smells her. They freak out. Kong tries to get out. How does a new Kong heart even work? It's a huge thing. They kind of skip over all of that. I don't quite understand. They put it in and it works. Kong gets out. There's a line of dialogue that I wrote down here because I wanted to make sure I gave you guys this tidbit of beautiful writing. Whenever Kong wakes up and he starts freaking out, somebody gets on the phone and says this line. The other monkey's gone ape shit. Yeah. So that's a reason you guys should watch this movie. Kong gets out. They both get out. They run away together. And I think this is all kind of a budgetary thing. A lot of this movie just takes place in the Georgia countryside. There's not a lot of, you know, wreaking havoc of the city in this movie, which is different than most Kong films. Kong and Lady Kong go on the run together. And there's, you know, the good humans and the bad humans are after him. I'm not even really going to talk about the humans that much in this movie because they're all pointless. There's not really, we just don't, there's the two main characters are trying to save the Kongs. Even though your main, the main guy, I don't have his name, I'm sure Jay has gone into all the technical things, and he's going to give you the name of the characters. He's going to give you the name of the actors. I'm just going to say that guy and Linda Hamilton. The guy, even though him and Linda Hamilton are kind of the good guys and they want to save Kong, he finds the Lady Kong and he sells her at the very beginning. So weird. So Kong and Lady Kong are chilling out. They're like flirting. There's all this weird, they're like smiling at each other. Lady Kong cleans off a wound on King Kong. They're like joking around. I think he grabs her butt at some point. That sounds like I'm joking, but that happens. They lay down, they have a bit. It's just like a whole bunch of weird, there's like cute music playing. There's close-ups of the Kong's eyes. At one point, Kong tries to give her a snake. He finds a snake and he picks it up. And it's a real live snake, by the way. He picks it up and he tries to give it to her. And she, like, it scares her and she kind of runs away. But the funniest thing about that scene is that, you know, Kong is just a man in a suit. But Kong in the film is, I don't know, 50 foot tall or something. He's huge. So when he picks up a snake, and it's like an actual real snake, the scale is off. So when that happens, I'm like, well, hold on. He just found like a fucking kaiju sized, like to him it's small, but if there was a human in that scene, that snake would be huge. Then there's a lot of weird scale issues in the movie, period. And I guess that's just something that happens in a lot of older monster movies. I don't know. One thing I am confused about is, were these two Kongs together in a relationship before King Kong got taken from Skull Island in the first movie? Now, they don't find Lady Kong on Skull Island. They find her somewhere else. But you get like one line of exposition where you hear somebody on the phone. It's even like a background thing. And he says like, oh, well, maybe Kong's land and Lady Kong's land used to be connected or something. So I wonder, because it's confusing, because these two Kongs meet, they don't even meet, they smell each other and they're like infatuated with each other and that's it. But I wonder, like, do they know each other? Were they previously in a relationship and they're happy to be found again? I don't know. It's not very clear. It all kind of feels thrown together. The whole movie feels sort of thrown together. It almost feels like a dream or like a nightmare, because it's like the movie starts off literally showing you the last few minutes of the previous film. Cut to 10 years later, we're in Georgia. It's such a big change. We're in the countryside most of the time. You got the military kind of after Kong. You got these, your other characters after him. It's just back and forth, back and forth. So they catch up with the Kongs and Lady Kong is captured. And then King Kong is running. He falls like off a cliff, or does he jump? I don't know. He falls into the water and it's this very strange scene. I don't know. I think the only point to what I'm about to say is because they needed Kong out of the picture and they weren't quite sure. So he's in the water and he hits his head on a rock and it's just shot very weirdly. Hits his head on a rock and goes underwater. You see lots of blood, and the head of the military says, "Not even your Kong could survive that." They all just assume that he's dead. They all just assume that Kong is dead, and they leave, and they just go. They don't look for a body. You know, it's... It makes absolutely no sense. But of course Kong's not dead. It, like, they have a couple, you know, there's some scenes back and forth where they're checking out Lady Kong. They at this point, they're kind of like, something's wrong with her. Is she just crying? Is she sad? We don't quite know yet, but she seems a little off. And then they just cut to the scene of Kong with the alligators. That's the next time you see him. And Kong is just, like, meandering around. Aimlessly walking, looking for Lady Kong and food. I think they even, there might even be a line of dialogue where they say, like, he can't find protein. Even if Kong's alive or something, he there's not enough food out there for him. And that's when they immediately cut to him eating like 7 alligators. And the alligators even cut back and forth from whenever Kong's got the alligator in his hand, it's a real alligator. And it's just a baby alligator. He's holding it. But whenever there are close-ups, the footage is of a full-grown alligator, and you can it's very easy to tell the difference between a baby and a full-grown. So it's very weird. And then you get more of these scenes of Kong just walking aimlessly, and there's a scene of this guy and his girlfriend. They're in their bedroom, and he gives her this weird line about her bedroom eyes. He's like, "You got bedroom eyes is what you got." And then this camera pans over and Kong is staring in at them. And this town, he kind of rampages through this small town just full of like rednecks. It's so weird. This movie is very, hold on. You know what? I'm going to get to that in a minute. So Kong has now made himself known. We know he's not dead. And then you get these hunters. They're trying to catch him. And they're like, it's just four rednecks who are going out on a boat. It's a lot like in Jaws when all the guys are going out on the boat. And it's just kind of like chaos. And they clearly don't know what they're doing. They just want to catch the shark. These hunters have some weird... They have like dynamite with them. And they somehow rig it so it explodes and it traps Kong in rubble all the way up to his head. So just his head is peeking out. And these guys start like tormenting Kong, and they're burning him and they're making fun of him. But, you know, King Kong is King Kong, and he gets out, and This is where things get a little crazy, if they're not already crazy. Kong grabs one of these guys, and he just rips him in half. He just pulls his body in half. Up until this point, Kong has been sort of, you know, there's a lot of scenes of him with Lady Kong, and he's being nice and silly and funny. And now he's just murdering people. And I know these hunters are... they're awful people, and you want them to die, but it's weird watching King Kong just kill them all. He rips this one guy in half, just pulls his body apart, picks up another guy, and eats him, just eats the guy. And then Kong's like got his finger in his mouth, and he's like digging around and pulls the guy's hat out. Guys, King Kong does not fuck around in this movie. You know what Kong's doing next? He's going to the golf course. Gonna take a little stroll and get a little hole in one, maybe. There is a scene in this movie, King Kong Lives, that I implore you to watch, because King Kong gets hit in the head with a golf ball. That happens. That happens in this movie. I think I might love this movie. I think I might love it. I don't know. And then we find out Lady Kong is pregnant. She's pregnant. She's going to give birth. Trying to be nice to her. Make sure everything's okay. Now we get into this very weird scene where there's like a party happening. And it is the most stereotypical rednecks you have ever seen. As I'm watching this movie, I'm like, one part of me is laughing at how insane all the Georgians are shown to be in this movie. It's as if whoever made this movie has never been to Georgia, and they were just like, oh, well, in Georgia, everybody's a hillbilly, right? They all eat squirrels. They're probably all inbred. They all wear overalls. And you can't understand any of them. And there's this scene of these guys like all dancing jigs and drinking moonshine. And it is so insane. And King Kong shows up. And he fucks it up. And he's getting shot. The military is here. They're trying to kill him. There's this really fun scene where the kind of head of the military who's sort of insane is shooting at Kong, and Kong just like makes a fist and just smashes the guy into the ground like as hard as he can. Kong will straight up murder you. He does not care. He does not give a fuck in this movie. And that's one of the things I like about it. All the weird shit is great, but seeing Kong just be like, you know what? You know, he's sort of a lovable, tragic figure in most iterations of the character, but here, I will say it's still sort of tragic in a way, but boy, who are we rooting for? Who are we supposed to be rooting? Like, all the people are awful. All the people that Kong is killing are awful. So I guess it makes you feel a little better, but it's still such a weird choice. So Kong kills this guy. While Kong is fighting the military, Lady Kong has fallen into like a barn. She's kind of, and she's going into labor, basically. So as Kong's fighting the military, he's getting shot up, by the way. He's covered, like he stands up at the end here and he's just drenched in his blood. And he falls and he's crawling over to the barn as Lady Kong is giving birth. Now she's giving birth to clearly a baby Kong. But something I said earlier about the scale being all over the place in this movie is that she gives birth to a baby that fits in the palm of her hand. And now I know babies are small. I don't have a whole lot of experience around babies, especially newborn babies. I've never had one or seen one right when it comes out, right when it's done or anything, but I don't think they fit in the palm of your hand. It's just, it gives the whole ending, even though they're trying to go for a touching, tragic ending here, it's still silly because you got somebody in a baby Kong suit in the palm of the hand of a giant. It's like, is that, if that's how big it is, I don't, whatever. It's weird. Anyway, Kong is dying. He's slowly dying and he sees his baby for the first time and he gets to, you know, hold baby Kong in his hand, and then he just dies. And that is a pretty tragic, you know, way to go. And, you know, I said at the beginning, Kong dies like three times in this movie. So, I mean, they're all kind of fake outs except for that last one. But, you know, you think he's dead at the end of the first Kong. He's in a coma for 10 years. He like almost has a heart attack at one point. He's like clutching his heart after getting too excited. He bashes his head on that rock and you think he might be dead for a little bit. And then at the end, he dies holding his baby son. Baby Kong is what I call him. And then they, you know, the movie ends pretty quickly after that. They buy like a preserve for Lady Kong and Baby Kong to live out their days. And it just ends and that's it. Yeah, so this is a very interesting movie. I'm really excited to hear what Jay has to say about this movie. It's one of those, like, it's one of those movies that you can look at it, you can step away from. When you see a movie as a kid, sometimes you might see a movie as a youngster and you might really love it, even if it sucks. And then when you grow up, you can kind of take a step back and it's like, all right, so I know this is not a good movie. I can look at this objectively and just be like, whoa, I can't believe this was made. But you can still enjoy it. And I think this movie is enjoyable. It's so weird. It has, you know, some fun sequences. You get to see Kong be a father. You get to see him be, you know, angry. You get to see him fucking murder people. You see him eat some alligators. you get to see him be a lover. You know what I mean? So you get all, he's very well-rounded in this film. He's a full character. We get all his emotions. It's more than you get in most other Kong movies, I guess. I don't know if that's what they were going for, but it's a huge step away from the 70s Kong that came out. And I kind of wish there were more of these weird, like, standalone King Kong movies. I mean, it sort of has a Skull Island feel to it, honestly. If you think about it, some of the plot points are kind of there. The main military guy in this movie sort of reminds me of Samuel L. Jackson's military character in Skull Island, because they both, for some reason, just, like, really hate Kong and take it upon themselves to, you know, try to take him down, and neither one succeed. But yeah, I think this movie's definitely worth watching. I think it's sort of like a hidden gem. Maybe a lot of people haven't heard of it, and that's partially because it's hard to get. The other movies out there, the first Kong, you know, they did like a special edition Blu-ray that I was really hoping they were just going to add King Kong Lives to it. I feel like it's only a matter of time before this movie gets a new release. I think it deserves it. It's just the weirdness of it. I can't imagine seeing this in a movie theater. And I hope one day I get to do that. You know, I think this was a fun little experiment doing this kind of an episode. I know I've already said this, but I'm really curious to see what Jay thinks here. I feel like it could go either way. I feel like he could be really mad at me that I made him watch this movie, or maybe he could just be so, you know, taken aback at what he just saw that maybe he'd be excited. But I feel like I want to leave you guys with one thing. I don't know if this is the kind of research Jay went into. I don't know if this is something that maybe would have popped up in his mind, but this is what I'm thinking. Gorillas are pregnant for around 8.5 months, about 8.5 months. So either after King Kong hits his head on that rock, there has to be about 8 months of time that goes by before they find out that Kong is still around. There has to be an 8 month time there. The only other option is, it's not Kong's baby! Thank you so much for listening, guys. Here is J.K.
Hello everyone, Jakey here, and if you've made it this far, I guess you've already listened to Jake's review, synopsis, opinions on King Kong Lives from 1986, and you know, I'm a little nervous. I have this gut feeling, and once again, as I'm recording this, I don't even know if Jake has watched King Kong Lives yet. I mean, I know he's seen it before, but I don't know if he's watched it specifically for this episode. So I'm a little nervous. I wonder if we're going to agree or disagree. And I have this kind of gut feeling that we might be on the opposite ends of the opinion spectrum when it comes to King Kong Lives. So, you know, when we discussed doing this, Jake immediately said King Kong Lives. And I'm like, have I seen King Kong Lives? I'd seen 76. I remember lots of my kind of initial opinions. And it had been a while since I'd seen King Kong 76. But I couldn't remember if I'd ever seen King Kong Lives. And it's funny, right when they got to the transplant scene, it was like my eyes opened, my brain awoke, and I was like, oh, I've seen this. Oh my gosh, like it even transplanted me, no pun intended there, transported me back to when I was younger and watching this in my brother's room. I mean, I still remember seeing this, and like I said, don't remember anything else about it, but that transplant scene, it kind of stuck, and it was really the signal, the beacon there to kind of jar that memory. So, you know, I was excited once I saw that to watch the rest of it to see if there were any more kind of those checkpoints And there wasn't. That's the only thing that I remember. So essentially, I was coming to this as if I'd never seen it before, even though I had back, you know, probably when I was 6 or 7 years old. So with that being said, I think before I get into my review and what I thought of the film and really what worked and what didn't, I should probably talk about my thoughts on just King Kong in general as a property, but as a kaiju. Because we talk about Godzilla, and I talk about Anguirus a lot, and Gorosaurus, and Titanosaurus, and all of these Toho, you know, more your kind of larger-than-life, bigger, like, Japanese kaiju. But we don't talk about, you know, the quintessential American kaiju, and one of the biggest stars in American cinema and film history, and that's King Kong. And I'll have to say, you know, it's hard to really talk about Kong without first talking about the 33 film, and we're not going to talk about actually the film itself, but just kind of what it means. I mean, it to me, like, it is one of the most important films in film history. It really is. What Willis O'Brien was able to do, the visual, just, and it's really the gritty storytelling, almost this, like, I don't know, like, it's hard to explain. It's almost like primitive, and you have like this very classic early American, you know, exploitation of, almost Carney-esque exploitation of this beast for, you know, for financial gain, and but it's done in this gritty, primitive storytelling. It's very raw, but yet you can even feel now how important and big it was back in 1933, the visual effects. And I guess the best way to put it is they took that film seriously. I mean, the filmmakers, and when Kong's fighting dinosaurs and all that type of stuff, there's nothing silly or funny about it. I mean, it is a true, serious drama. And I think that there are few films that have made an impact on cinema and on film and on movies as much as King Kong 1933. And it still stands up today. I do watch it every now and then. And I love it just as much as I did when I saw it the very first time when I was a kid. And you know, it's amazing. But I'm going to stop there. I'm going to have a, you know, hard stop there about all my thoughts on Kong 33. Because King Kong, as a kaiju, as a monster, as a lead actor, if you will, he's really on the bottom of my list. And I know that's sacrilegious to American kaiju fans and just kaiju fans in general. But I've never had that connection where I rooted for Kong. I mean, hell, even in 33, I was the kid rooting for the dinosaurs. You know, I was the kid rooting for the pit monster and everything, like, against Kong. And I know that's terrible, but there was just something about a giant ape that didn't speak to me. Maybe it was because I was a Mesozoic kid, not a Cenozoic kid. I don't know. But there just wasn't that connection that was ever made between myself and Kong. So, you know, I never played with George on Rampage as a kid. Let's just put it that way. I mean, even in, like, King Kong Escapes, I was still mad that he beat Gorosaurus. I was rooting for Mechani Kong. I think that is important as we review, you know, one of the lesser Kong films, lesser known Kong films in King Kong Lives, is that I don't have this, you know, this preconceived connection to the beast where I'm automatically rooting for him. Whereas if you would have made a bad Godzilla movie, and we know there's been some, I'm still going to root for him. I still am going to have that connection, that emotional tie to Godzilla, and I don't have that with Kong. And I know I'm in the minority of kaiju fans. Kong is, you know, I mean, he might be the number one even over Godzilla as far as the most important monster in the history of monsters. But to me, it just, I don't know. It never worked. So is that going to just, I don't know, influence my views on the film? Maybe. I mean, it's part of it. But I wanted you guys to know that so when if I'm critical of something, you know, it might be coming from a place that I just don't have that love of Kong that's wired into my brain that is always going to be there. It's funny, you know, Jake and I talked about this when, oddly enough, in the great cinema swap, when we talked about Yamada Takaru and how a lot of that mythology, the characters, you know, of Oda Tachibana, of Yamada Takaru, that the Japanese people that were watching this film, they knew these characters from just growing up in stories. You know, we use, I think, Santa Claus as a reference, right? Like, you don't need to have a backstory and origin on Santa Claus. If you see him in a film, you see him in a media property, you kind of know what you're going to get, right? You kind of know the table stakes of the Santa Claus character. And, you know, and same thing with, like I said, in Yamada Takaru, like, it's Japanese mythology. And to some, like, table stakes for Kong is, like, he is this tragic, exploited character, but they have this, you know, this preconceived love of Kong that, you know, will infiltrate a film without the necessary, you know, emotional arc or the character development in the story. It's not needed because it's Kong. And of course, this one also had this is a sequel, so you have that 1976 to build up to it as well. So I just wanted everybody to know that my love of Kong is very lukewarm compared to most. So the other piece to this was, it is a sequel to 1976, so I felt I would be doing the film a great disservice if I didn't at least watch 1976 before going into King Kong Lives, and I did that. And it's just so crazy to think. I mean, 76 could be its own freaking podcast, not even episode. There's so much with that film. I mean, you have, I don't think this is hyperbole, you might have two of the greatest American actors ever in that film. You have, of course, Jessica Lange. I mean, it's her first film role, yes. But I mean, we're talking about somebody that went on to win the acting Triple Crown, Oscar, Emmy, Tony. And she's just done so much. It is one of the greatest. I mean, you put her up there with, you know, with Meryl Streep, more of the kind of the modern age. And it's just untouchable. And then you pair her with Academy Award winner, SAG winner, Golden Globe winner, Jeff Bridges, who for my money might be the greatest modern male actor in the English-speaking world. I mean, he truly is that good. Now, I would say that maybe this performance was more Tron and less Crazy Heart, but that's for a different podcast as well. So you have Jeff Bridges and Jessica Lange. Oh, but we're not done. You throw in Charles Grodin. I mean, Emmy winner, Golden Globe nominated, one of the, you know, a comedian, a comic legend. How many Johnny Carson appearances did that guy have? And somebody that obviously has his own cachet within the world of entertainment. I mean, it's produced by Dino De Laurentiis, who's, you know, talking about 500 plus movies, 38 nominated for Oscars. You're talking about Carlo Rambaldi, who won three Oscars. And oh yeah, not only King Kong, Alien and E.T., yeah, he designed those. He's part of the special effects team for those films. So it's just nuts that he's also involved in this project. And the suit was designed by him and maybe the greatest special effects pioneer of all time, Rick Baker. I think 11, 12, 15, who knows how many Oscar nominations that guy has. So you have Rambaldi and Rick Baker working on the Kong suit. You know, in the acting and the supporting cast, you have more Tony winners. You have Rene Auberjonois, Odo from Deep Space Nine, for all you Star Trek fans. And then John Randolph, who played the captain, also a Tony winner. And of course, directed by John Guillermin, who is did The Towering Inferno. He did both of these Kongs, but I mean, he also did Death on the Nile, the follow-up to Murder on the Orient Express, with basically a who's who of British actors and actresses. I think Dame Maggie Smith is in that one. It's just insane. You have an all-star cast. But there's just so much controversy around that film, and whether it's the rights issues and the studios battling it out, whether it's the ridiculous, you know, I did the math with inflation, and it ended up being $4.4 million giant robot gorilla that ended up being used for 15 seconds. So, you know, and a very ambitious Rambaldi there, but you had that weighed down production and the film being released. I mean, you have so much other kind of myth around this and legend. A lot of it is true. You know, the Dino De Laurentiis saying that he considered Meryl Streep, but she wasn't attractive enough for the role of Dwan. I think that was crazy. But anyway, that it is a big production with a who's who around it. So I was excited to go back and revisit this film as my appetizer, my launching pad into King Kong Lives. And, you know, I mean, yes, it's visually appealing. 76 is visually appealing. It won an Oscar for special effects. I mean, it has something there. But to me, it was so different than 33 in the fact that it was, it's just a little love story. You know, but yet one that's like, it lacks really, I think, any like authenticity or really heart. It meanders a lot. And it just didn't have that primitive feel, that edge, that, I don't know, that emotional grab of the 33 film. And it didn't take itself seriously. And like I mentioned before, in the 33, I think that was what worked about it. They treat it very seriously. It is a serious drama. And here, there's some, I don't know, I wouldn't say there was all out, you know, eye winks and head nods to the camera by any means. But I felt it didn't take itself seriously, and it wanted to be kind of this more happy, upbeat love story that also features this, you know, giant ape. And I feel that I want to kind of stick a pin in that and that kind of notion, to where it took the story of Kong, which was, you know, I think made famous by this primitive, just gritty tale, and it made it something else. And I'd stick a pin in that, because I do think that that's something we'll talk about as we review kind of the main event here, which is King Kong Lives. But at the end of the day, like, King Kong 76, it was underwhelming to me. It's not one I'm going to go back and revisit again. It just is kind of there. And I think it doesn't, to me, compare closely to 33 in any way, both as from a stylistic standpoint or a critical standpoint. And so, you know, it's just there. It didn't necessarily give me pump for King Kong Lives, but it made me curious as how they go 10 years later, how they take this film and go into King Kong Lives. But, you know, 76 had its, you know, it was one of the highest grossing films, I think, of 76, and there was some box office success to it. But at the end of the day, it's just not a film that I particularly care for. So you go from that, and even though Dino De Laurentiis wanted to make a sequel right away, it took him 10 years, a decade later. So what are you going to do with this story, considering, you know, Kong falls off of the World Trade Center and is presumably dead? How do you pick that up 10 years later? So, you know, it's still Dino De Laurentiis, it's still Carlo Rambaldi, it's still John Guillermin that are kind of leading the charge here. But we don't have the Jessica Langs, we don't have the Jeff Bridges, we don't have the Charles Grodins of the world that are really driving from an acting standpoint. But we have a lot more feathered hair, thanks to Linda Hamilton and Brian Kerwin, the lead opposite Linda Hamilton, or we'll refer to him as some soap opera guy. So, you know, the production to this was not as crazy and wacky as 76, but it wasn't like they had this one idea that made so much sense and they could just go there and just knock it out because they knew exactly what they wanted to do. You know, Stephen Pressfield, the famed author who did some writing credits on this, he said that they had ideas of King Kong in Russia, which in 1986 would have been insane, probably more insane than King Kong in outer space, which is another thing that they really considered. I mean, he mentions that these are not exaggerations. And they even had one that had little kids that were kind of, you know, basically Kong, they adopted Kong, and he was going to go around and step on things with little kids. Hey, don't do that, don't do that. So, like, it just, as Pressfield described it, it was an embarrassment. Now, did they improve on that? We'll see here in a second. But another note from 86 is that, you know, this movie, with a couple other kind of bombs that Dino De Laurentiis had at around the time, I think Taipan 2 and some other ones, they just got basically destroyed. His production company in DEG, I think he was booted out, and they eventually went out of business there. So this is probably not fondly remembered by former employees of DEG. But so there you have that going for it. And as you go through the film, as you watch it, it's very clear that the budget had been reduced significantly from 1976 to 1986, which is a shame, because the visuals from 76, which won an Academy Award, were pretty stunning. You know, it was, like I said, visually appealing. So that's kind of the cast of characters. Oh, you also have John Ashton there, who's like, you know, character actor extraordinaire. You know, anybody, if you ever played like a gruff military guy or a tough dad or something like that, I mean, John Ashton was your guy. So he's in this film as well. So that's kind of the setup here. And as far as a premise, the, you know, I'll do a brief here synopsis. This is kind of the best way that I can describe King Kong Lives from a storyline standpoint, and definitely spoilers here, but you know, I feel 1986, I think we have the ability to do that without feeling too bad spoiling it. You've had some time, people. So this is the best way that I can recap King Kong Lives. King Kong survives the fall from the World Trade Center and has been living for 10 years with an artificial heart. Sarah Connor's his doctor, and she says that he needs blood in what is one of the best instances of serendipitous cinematic timing. Some soap opera actor with beautiful feathered hair playing Indiana Jones, Jack Hanna, Steve Irwin, insert wildlife guy with fancy hat here, discovers a female Kong. Having fallen in love, these newlywed Kongs are tired of living in separate houses and move to the country. But an insane colonel and his trusty cigar recapture Lady Kong, and Mr. Kong falls again, this time from a cliff into a raging river and presumed dead again. But he's not. He's in the Everglades, eating alligators and snapping drunk swamp folk like twigs. And Indiana Jones and Sarah Connor fall in love, too, with their beautiful feathered hair. They sneak by the competent military security detail, because it's a movie, and attempt to free Lady Kong from her underground bunker. The military does stop them. Hey, nice one, guys. But a pissed off Kong ends up saving her. They are tracked by Colonel Cigar to a hillbilly family reunion where Mr. Kong destroys the entire army. Lady Kong has a baby in a barn, or on a barn, and Kong dies. And the baby looks a lot like, I don't know, the cousin of Stink from Land of the Lost. Lady Kong and her weirdly shaped son retire to Borneo, and luckily, we don't see them again. That's the best way that I can describe King Kong Lives. I don't know. Maybe I missed some things there, but that's essentially the movie in a nutshell. And so, you know, how I'm going to do this, I think I'm going to break it up to where I talk about what I did like and what I didn't like, and then kind of overall thoughts, because the movie is, it's interesting. It is a lot. So what I did like, let's start with positives here. I like that it picked up right from the last film. I'm a sucker for that because I don't want to have to sit through the first few minutes and try to figure out, is this a direct sequel? Is this a sequel, but they've have some continuity errors? Like, I felt really good that, hey, this the end scene from the first film kicks it off, bam, we know what's going to happen. It's 10 years later, but this is in the same universe, the same characters apply, everything, you know, the laws of that universe and of Kong and what he is and what he isn't makes sense here and applies here. So that to me is great. And I love that in sequels. And you know, and 10 years later, that's not always the case. So I did dig that piece quite a bit. And I like that it did focus on Kong and Lady Kong. That in itself isn't bad. You know, the fact that the human characters were made more secondary, where in the first one, even though the spectacle of Kong in the 1976 one was bigger than maybe the characters, the A storyline still involved Jeff Bridges and Jessica Lange. So Linda Hamilton and Brian Kerwin's characters were definitely second fiddle here. The love story of the Kongs totally took precedence and priority over the love story between our two human actors. And like I said, that isn't bad if executed properly. So I dig that. I mean, they at this point, I don't know if any of the other Kong films had really been able to successfully do that. And yet, here they go trying it. So I love the ambition. I love the kind of changing the story where the A love story is focused on the giant monsters. And then I like, you know, speaking of that, kind of like the B or C love story, but I loved how we always think of Kong and, you know, the damsel in distress, be it Fay Wray or Jessica Lange or whoever. And in this one, it was Lady Kong who had the little crush on Brian Kerwin's character, Mitchell, I believe it is. Now, that was fun. It wasn't a major part. It was kind of a couple throwaway scenes there, but just that connectivity I thought was a fun riff on it, and it made sense, and that I thought was a nice little touch. I thought that was fun. And And you know, we'll say with Lady Kong here, I actually liked her design a lot better than I did King Kong's design. Now, I'm not going to comment on the suits because, you know, in 1986, I think they were pretty solid. And I think they hold up today a lot of the, just as far as like how, especially in the face, how it comes across as a giant monstrous gorilla. I mean, there's a reason Rimbaldi and Rick Baker are who they are. I think overall the Kong design is fine. Like, it's not inspiring to me. It's fine. But the Lady Kong design, I thought, made her still look like a giant ape, but feminine and different enough to where I could tell them apart. I mean, yes, she's smaller and there's some other things, but I thought it was a good looking and the right amount of human elements to it. I thought it was great. I really, really did like her design. You know, they could have gone over the top, and they didn't. They could have made her, you know, albino, you know, like Son of Kong or something. They could have done something, made her drastically different, but they stayed within that same kind of color palette and quote-unquote realism and made her, I think, a very good design. That is not a universally agreed upon position, but I personally, found the Lady Kong design more compelling than I did, you know, Mr. Kong. So, you know, I think when I watched this movie, the first few scenes had me really optimistic because I thought the artificial heart, the heart transplant scene with Linda Hamilton, you know, being the lead doctor and everything, I thought that was actually a really good scene. I thought they took it very seriously. To me, it came across as like, hey, like if we're giving a heart transplant to a 50-foot gorilla, what is it going to look like? I felt like, and with the technology in the mid-80s, I thought that was really good. And I'm like, okay, they're going to take themselves seriously. Now, the counter to that, kind of the Borneo scenes with Mitchell and the natives and the, you know, Lady Kong, we'll see. I don't know if I would say that gave me huge optimism, but the artificial heart transplant scene is one of my favorite because, once again, it harkened back to them taking it seriously and playing it very seriously, which I think was paramount to the success of Kong 33 and why that film works. And really, a lot of kaiju movies. I mean, Jake and I have talked about that on other podcasts. Is like, I think we were talking about Space Amoeba, how silly Ghezara is in design, in function, in just concept. I mean, it's a giant cuttlefish that, you know, walks upright and you can see the actor's feet. But the actors in the film play it seriously, and it makes Ghezara work. And I think when they play these seriously, it helps out the overall film. Now, I will say that doesn't stay that way in this film, and I think that's one of my bigger issues. But we're not there yet. So the artificial heart transplant scene, I think, is one of the best scenes in the entire film. The other is, and you know, the end scene, and once again, spoilers here, the end scene with Kong. You know, I think if you ask me, should Kong have died? Should they have killed off Kong once and for all in this little duology, if you will? My gut probably going into this would be like, no. I mean, he survives a 1,400-foot fall. How are you going to kill him off? It has to be something grand and dramatic. And should he die just by the hands of a, you know, an assault from a small army regiment? No. But with that being said, the facials and the moment at the very end with Lady Kong and their son and just kind of the close-up of the facials of Kong, I thought were exquisite. It was really, to me, the only moving emotional scene in this entire film. So to kill Kong, which I don't know if was the right call, especially in the kind of the, not anticlimactic, but not as grand way that the guy died. I mean, I guess his heart was failing too, because he had an artificial heart, but that's, you know, that seems like almost such a cheap way to die for a giant kaiju. But because of that, we get this, what I think is this 10 seconds of really emotional, visually gripping film. So, not to be too Machiavellian, but I do think the ends justify the means here, to where, okay, you got to kill him to get me that moment. I just wish there were more moments like that throughout the film, and you could have done something there. But that's because of so many other things failed. But I would say the continuity from the original, the design of Lady Kong, the focusing on Kong and Lady Kong in theory, and the transplant scene and the Kong's facials in that final scene are really, to me, the things that work in this film, that I liked in this film. What I didn't like. So if we shift gears here, and, you know, to be transparent, there's a lot more of these than I did like. But even though it did pick up right from the last film, I felt like they ignored, you know, Petrox Oil and Dwan and the Jeff Bridges character and all that type of stuff. Did they need to have them in the film, like, as actual main pieces? No, of course not. But to mention, I mean, they were so integral to Kong even coming stateside, I felt they could have had some sort of offhand mention, an article, a newspaper article clipping or something, especially Petrox Oil. I mean, not even mentioned. And whether they went bankrupt or something, I wish they would have closed the loop on there. But that's a nitpick. That I'm starting out small here. The other thing that's really small that is just mind-blowing is, as you guys watch this, did you notice for a split second, the film is shot from the perspective of a frog? Yes! Yes, in the alligator scene, which we'll talk about in a second, they shot it from the perspective of a frog. Why? Like, why? Is it the only time that in a kaiju film that, you know, even a mere flash has been shown from the perspective of an amphibian? I don't know. So we have that. But that, once again, we're picking nits here. But let's talk about some of the bigger issues. And these are, I think, just destroy this film and bring it down to the point to where it is just, I'm not going to say this is an unwatchable film. I'm going to say this is a bad film that is not overly enjoyable. And I want there to be, I want it to come across as charming and fun and goofy and campy, but it doesn't do that. And it doesn't come across as serious and a good piece of filmmaking. So, like, it fails on every facet. But some of the bigger issues. First off, I talk about how I liked Lady Kong's design. As good as that was, even though we only see him for a second, the design of the sun is very weird. I mean, it looks very Land of the Lost, and the proportions are funky, and he's really, really small, and I don't know. It just, it made me kind of like, what? And I started thinking about how does it look like that instead of, like, trying to grasp this very endearing, important emotional moment. So that's not good. When the design is so bad, it takes you out of what the film is trying to do. That is, I think, crucial in kaiju films, especially the older ones. I mean, we know that there's going to be, you know, especially in Godzilla films, I mean, the suit's coming apart half the time. There's wires that can be seen. And if they take you out of what you're supposed to be feeling in that scene, that's an issue. That's a problem. And this one did. Luckily, it was picked back up by, like I mentioned before, the great facials from Kong that really did convey a lot of emotion. But that's like kind of number one, like bad. The other thing that I think was really, I don't know, it really took away from the film, and I just think it goes to the, in the bucket of poor filmmaking, poor storytelling, poor characters, is just how many stock characters can you put into one film? I mean, drunk rednecks with guns, a crazy military-minded colonel, you know, dumb, incompetent guards that can be easily fooled by anybody. I mean, these are, like, just right out of, you know, this, the playbook. And they work for, you know, for many films. That's why they became stock characters. But, like, come on, King Kong Lives. Be better than that. You're already working uphill because you're a kaiju movie in America with men in monkey suits or ape suits. You got to do better than that. And it, like I said, it was just a little almost off-putting and almost a slap in the face to the viewing audience. Like, yeah, these have been done and overdone, and give me something. Give me a reason this crazy Colonel Nevitt is crazy. Why is he so insane? Did he, you know, I need something there. The drunk rednecks, I mean, I get there. It's kind of like a mob mentality. Like, there's just a group of characters, so you can't really dive deep in there. But why is the Colonel his way? Like, he had enough screen time to understand that. you know, a little bit more backstory on Linda Hamilton's character. A little bit more backstory on Mitchell. How does one become an adventurer, a professional adventurer that has ties in Borneo and has this connection with the natives? Like, I need more instead of getting these kind of like cardboard characters. And then when you couple cardboard characters with stiff cardboard acting, not a winning combination. I mean, I love Linda Hamilton to death. And this is early Linda Hamilton, not her best work, though she's, I think, is fine in it. But, you know, Kerwin is goofy and not really believable in that role. And like I said, love John Ashton to death. And he plays kind of that one note, he's a character actor, that one note gruff guy. But like, it's like he just mailed it in and did like a greatest hits of evil colonels in 1980s movies. And everybody else surrounding them is just, like I said, it's just, they're just so kind of flat. And that's disappointing because the movie's already failing on some other things. If you could have a wonderful performance, I can bring it up, and that just didn't happen here. So outside of that, so we have this idea of, okay, let's try to make it even more goofy and campy and lovable and lighthearted as 1976. Let's take what Jay didn't like about the first one, not taking itself seriously, and amp it up to 11. And that's, once again, that's fine. But if you're going to be funny, you got to be funny. The bad comedy, the golf ball hitting Kong when he's rampaging through the country club and stepping on the car and the kid going, "My dad's going to kill me." And the dumb guard obviously just got a call in that there's a break-in, and Linda Hamilton opens the door, and the first thing he says is, "Hello, Mama." Like, no. Once again, be better than that. King Kong Lives. You know, the hillbilly family reunion at the end with the barn, the manger where baby Jesus Kong is born. Like, that, just the you never know who's going to show up at these things from the redneck guys. Like, come on. Like, this is bad, not good comedy. Like, they did surface level bad comedy. And so they didn't, because of that, they didn't win on that side. They didn't win on taking seriously side. They didn't win on these amazing dramatic performances side. So they're losing on all fronts here. And there's nothing for me to hang my hat on to say, this is why I like to watch King Kong Lives. And I think because these attempts at comedy fail, it loses a lot of its charm, or it never captures that quality of being charming, is probably a better way to put it. You know, there's some other things that I think that are worth talking about. You know, I think you get, oh, another one of the goofy moments. I forgot the whole when Kong smiles after killing Nevitt with his, you know, he smashes him with his fist. Okay. I mean, that's, to me, that's a little bit of a trope. I'm sure we've seen that in a lot of monster films and other things like that, but it just doesn't work because, once again, there's so many flawed attempts at comedy here. The other thing I think we should talk about is, if it is going to be lighthearted and it is going to be more just kind of fun and goofy and attempt to be charming as 76, do you really need the Kong ripping humans in half and eating them? Like with the drunk rednecks. Yeah, they deserved it. They're bad. I wanted to see Kong kill them. Yeah, 100%. They were torturing him. They're bad dudes. 100%. But that almost felt like it belonged in a low-budget horror movie if you would have gone with that vibe. It didn't fit with what they're trying to accomplish. I mean, you have, in a matter of like 5 minutes, you have, you know, him getting hit in the face with a golf ball, and you have him ripping a human in half. And also biting the heads and ripping off alligators and carrying his, you know, his a little rope full of alligators, you know, that he's eating. Which, once again, no issues. I know Jake might have issues with him eating alligators, as much of a fan of, you know, alligators, crocodiles, caimans, and gharials that he is. But that, to me, like how he needs to get his protein. He's in the Everglades. He eats alligators. Totally cool. I get that. But like, it just, once again, it feels like somebody said, "Hey, I have a great idea for a scene. Let's have him rip a human in half. Let's have him rip an alligator in half," and just stick it in the film where it doesn't fit. So, you know, what are you trying to be? You know, King Kong Lives, and then let's do a better job of trying to actually be that. So I think that is just another example of how overall, it just doesn't work. And then, of course, I mentioned it earlier, just the overall premise of he can survive a fall from the World Trade Center. Yeah, he was in a coma for 10 years, but he's once again killed by, you know, just some tanks and stuff. I don't know. It feels, once again, like a cheaper death. Like, he deserved a bigger, more grandiose death. I don't know. He maybe get blown up, shot into outer space. I don't know. Fall into a volcano, maybe. We know that didn't really work very well for Godzilla, you know, a year or two earlier. But maybe for Kong, I just felt it was a lackluster death. So, even though continuity was apparent from the first film, I felt like they could have done more. Really, the fall was really the only thing connecting them. Some of just the weird, silly scenes, whether it's a perspective of a frog or whether it's, you know, dumb, incompetent guards or drunk rednecks or, you know, stepping on dad's car or whatever it might be. Just the attempt to try to take that idea that I'm going to be a Kong movie, but not super serious, but then not succeeding on being not super serious and failing in all the comedy attempts. And then, of course, just kind of the misplaced violence and some of the weird, like, just kind of ripping people in half thing. All of that, like, when you put that and then you surround it with this really, really cardboard characters and cardboard acting, it just makes this a film that I just don't like. It is just not a good film. And for a kaiju like Kong that I don't necessarily just jump to watch their films anyway, I need something there. And this film just simply doesn't have it. So overall, you know, I think what didn't work for me in 76 was even exaggerated more here in 86. And basically they made that into an entire movie. I don't ever feel any connection to Kong or any of the characters or Lady Kong or anything really until the end scene. And the humans are entirely useless. They really are entirely useless, whether they're caricatures of stock characters or just because of the overall wooden acting. At least they had nice feathered hair. But, you know, I think 76 is by far the better film. You know, better acting, a more coherent plot, you know, less bad jokes. They had some, but less bad jokes. You know, I get why some people would like 86 better. You know, it's not as boring, maybe. And some people might like some of the lesser special effects. I mean, I think some people just assume like it's less, you know, and not practical, because both had practical effects, obviously, but less high quality, lower budget equals charming. And to some degree, yeah. But also, if it's just bad because it's not executed well, and there's not because of financial limitations, and then it's just bad. It's not charming. And I just don't feel that any of the comedy or anything that would make it kind of funny works. So it doesn't, to me, it doesn't have that heart or that charm. And here's the thing, like, if we'd looked at it and it would have been not funny but so bad, it was funny, but it's not even that. It's just bad. And so I just, like I said, 76, I'll give it a pass as far as, like, it's fine, but I just don't have any desire to watch it. 86, I'm not going to rewatch it, but I can see how other people would enjoy it from a rewatchability standpoint, kind of a guilty pleasure film, you know, but not this guy, not me. And then, you know, I love to tie it back to more traditional Japanese kaiju, and we'll say with King Kong. A lot of people say King Kong Lives and King Kong Escapes have a, I don't know, not a connective tissue in a plot, but in spirit. Right? They're, you know, whereas you have Kong 76 and King Kong versus Godzilla, bigger budget, more grandiose, you know, I think probably reached more people and more people, you know, recognize it and remember it and like the films. And then you have these kind of waited a good while and had these sequels that, you know, of course, King Kong Escapes doesn't necessarily tie into that one, but, you know, they're both a little bit more campy, a little bit more silly. And, you know, they try to go just a little bit of a different direction or focus on some of the elements of the initial film and exaggerate and amplify them. I love King Kong Escapes because guess what? It does camp well. I mean, from the over-the-top nature of Doctor Who to, you know, the insane design of Mechani-Kong, But here's the thing. It knows what it's doing can't be, but it still takes itself seriously in the right ways. Whereas King Kong Lives, it doesn't ever go the full way. It just goes with these cheap, kind of cliched jokes and characters and doesn't embrace what it's trying to be. And when it needs to take itself seriously, it doesn't. And so I think that King Kong Escapes is a better version of what King Kong Lives is trying to do. Now, and here's the other thing. King Kong Escapes came out, you know, 20 years, 19 years before it. So, I mean, it had something to look at, what King Kong Lives was trying to do, but I don't know. I am not by any means against campy and goofy. I mean, look at the films that I watch. I mean, I love so much of that, but if I'm going to watch a goofy King Kong film, I'm watching King Kong Escapes 10 times out of 10 over King Kong Lives. And it's not even close. And in that design, a Kong is one of the worst of all time, that the King Kong Escapes. But yet still, they take it seriously. He's still treated as what he is. But here, it's just they can't deliver. And I don't know if this is a film that it's like, hey, if they would have done this differently, it would fix it. I think there's just too many flaws. There's just too many issues with King Kong Lives that I don't know. It's not one of my favorite ones. I don't have a rating system, but it's at the bottom. You know, of all the movies we've talked about on here, it's definitely at the bottom. Now, would I rather watch this or Godzilla versus Megaguirus? I'm still probably going to watch King Kong Lives. Let's be real. But it's not that bad. But it's also, in the world of kaiju, it's in the bottom tier for me. It's definitely in the bottom tier, and I hate that, because my gut says that Jake likes this. I'm so curious, guys. I'm so curious to see what he says. But to me, no thank you. And so for those that want to watch these films, like, I'd love to hear the feedback, because, you know, 76 has been pretty controversial, kind of split down the middle. King Kong Lives as well, I think, for different reasons, but it's an interesting, you know, they have an interesting place in the world of Kong. You know, they do. You have 33, which is beloved. You have King Kong versus Godzilla, which to me is still a very overrated film, but, you know, it's known by so many people. And then you book in that with Kong Skull Island, and even before that, you know, the Peter Jacksons, which, you know, overall, most of these have very positive opinions. And then you have sandwiched in the middle these two films, 76 and King Kong Lives. And like I said, they are an interesting chapter in the long history of King Kong, you know, the true American kaiju. So I love this idea, and I hope that we visit the other Kong movies in a greater detail later. Hopefully not in one of these Jay versus Jake segments, but hopefully one where we can have an open discussion, and Jake's love of Kong hopefully will offset some of my just kind of indifference to Kong as a kaiju. So that's it. You know, sorry guys. I mean, maybe it's good that I didn't like it for once, because, you know me, I love most of the stuff I watch outside of Godzilla versus Megaguirus. And yeah, I'd love to hear from you. And of course, I don't know if Jake said this in his podcast, and if he didn't, I know he means it, and he's thinking it is, thank you for listening to us on YHS and Monster Island. We love doing this. I love being part of the YHS universe. And so go check out Yes Have Some Prime, YHS Prime with Craig and Abby and Jake, or Toy Anxiety, which, you know, airs on Tuesday nights. And it is just, it's the hit sensation across the toy collecting nation. And it is amazing that with those three plus Ryan Dole, and then you have Bad Bitches with that Abby leads with Kat Hansen and Ryan Dole, and sometimes Jake Stevens from For Lom Dezuckus. And there's so many other things going on in the YHS world, that in the YHS universe, go check them out. But for me, I just want to thank you for listening to YHS on Monster Island, because, you know, there's a ton of kaiju podcasts out there. So it means a lot. It really, really, really does. So take care. Go watch a kaiju movie. Go buy a kaiju toy. And hey, I'll catch you next time, everybody. A big adios.
Join us on a trip to Monster Island, where the beasts of terror hunt you down. If you're brave and strong, you'll last the trip. But if you're slow, you'll probably be never found.